This is, as Evelyn mentioned, designated across our nation Pastor Appreciation Day. And we do appreciate being appreciated. We thank you for your kindnesses, and I'm thankful that you don't wait until October to do it. You're so kind to us all the time. And I thank you, and I appreciate it so very much. And I was given the directive to mention that if anybody in this room didn't know we were having dinner today and didn't come prepared, you are prepared if you're hungry. If you want to eat, you're welcome to join us. And we would love to have you. If it's anything, I haven't been down there to peek, but... But if it's anything like normal, there is more than sufficiency. And I have heard that there are some special things that have been made just for me. And so if you see me go to one spot in particular, it's mine first. And then you can have some too. But we thank you again, and we welcome you to be with us this afternoon for our time of celebration. I think it was one day this week, Emma and I went to a pastor school this week. I told someone yesterday, after all of these years, I'm really trying to learn how to do this right. And I'm finding out the longer I go, the worse I've been doing all along. But we did have some wonderful teaching and fellowship with some wonderful ministers from all over the Appalachian area of Virginia. And had a moment or two of relaxation there in the Gatlinburg area. And it was a good week. But it was primarily for and about pastors. And there was some new stuff. Not new as far as programs or ways to do things. But for us, there was some newness from the Word. Especially concerning the scripture that says, "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And I have many, many times in the role of a pastor looked at that scripture and said, "Lord, are you sure this is what you meant? Because it doesn't feel so light right this moment. It doesn't feel easy right this moment." And the teacher, who is from north part of Texas, shared that many, many, many times the reason that our yoke gets heavy and we get so wearisome is because we've got out of yoke with what the Lord is doing. Instead, we're yanking on the yoke, saying, "Lord, come on, come on, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is what I want to do. This is what everybody else is doing. Come on, Lord, come on." And struggling against the yoke just wears you out. God had intended. So I will tell you that after this week, my main prayer for my ministry has been, "Lord, let me find what you want, what your purpose is and what your will is. Let me find your timing so that I will find that place that the yoke is easy and the burden is light, because it's not my burden, it's not my yoke. So that's what I am trying to learn from this week." I think it was after we got back, Evelyn stopped by her office, her ex-office, praise God, and to visit with some of her ex-co-workers. And I think this was when this was stated to her. Someone said to her, "I don't see how in the world you make it being a pastor or a pastor's wife after all that's expected of you and after the schedule that you live." And we have heard from some of our neighbors about our schedule, and it intrigues them somewhat. Why would anybody be a pastor? Well, let me tell you a couple of things. Number one, I didn't go to a job fair and look at a listing of posters where they had jobs listed and see one that said pastor and said, "That's the one I want." No, Virginia High School, I went to a job fair and I saw the posters and I said, I want to be a pharmacist. Can you see me? Well, there was only one problem with me being a pharmacist. It's called biology. And for some reason, they don't let you in pharmacy school with D's in biology. I kind of majored in biology. Then in college, I took biology in three different colleges because they don't transfer D's. So I found out right quickly, but pharmacy was not my purpose. So I chose instead to be an architect. And I was going to be an architect. Every once in a while, in the midst of that, I would think that I was going to be a band director or a country singer or, you know, those kind of crazy thoughts that still are in my mind. but I was on the career path to be an architect. Until one night, in a cat meeting service in May, Virginia, I went there to be honest with my friend Johnny Graybill, because there were pretty girls there from around Southwest Virginia. Johnny and I went to shop. And the preacher, who had been my pastor as a little boy, and I've noticed just this week, just went to be with Jesus over this last month, stood to preach, and he said, I had a sermon prepared on the seven churches of Revelation, and I thought, go ahead. Sounds too deep for me, so I can sleep. He said, but instead, the Lord wanted me to share this. And he started to share from his heart. And I could not ignore him. I even left the room and went outside. And as I stepped out the front door, this was an old campground, there was a bullhorn speaker over top of the door. And the Word of God kept coming to me. And I know it sounds like an old gospel song, but before that night was over, I was on my face in sawdust, committing my life to Jesus Christ. Amen. And when I stood from that moment, I stood and proclaimed to my friend who was beside me, I've got to go to Bible school. Family was excited somewhat. My girlfriend was not. She told me to go somewhere else instead of Bible school. I told her I was trying my very best not. But that started trail of ministry that has lasted some 43 years. I'm thankful for every year. Have they all been easy? My word, no. If you've been here very long, you know better than that. There's not been one Shangri-La church that I've found yet. I keep looking for them. But now at my age, they're not looking for me. But everywhere we've been able to minister, we've seen God do some remarkable things. All not things they write books about necessarily. Things that are in a better book. As we've even this week heard from one young couple, and I would ask you to pray for Debbie. Debbie Hearn has found out this week that she has a mass, and they're doing tests this week to find out what it is and how they can treat it. Debbie and Randy live in Columbus, Georgia. In the last week of our ministry there, I'd been their youth pastor, and Randy had been the thorn in my flesh. He was pain. But on the last week there, I asked for he and his girlfriend Debbie to come to our home for pizza. And Randy and I went to get the pizza, and on the way, I said, Randy, before I leave this town, I've got to ask you, please, please consider letting Jesus have your life. You're a mess. I said, would you at least think about it for me? And he said, yes, sir, I will. So it got real quiet in the car. We went and picked up the pizza, headed back to the house, got within a block of the house, and he said, Pastor Herb. I said, yeah, Randy. He said, I'm ready. I said, ready for what? He said, what you asked me. We went in the house, took the pizza to the kitchen, and Randy and I went to the bedroom. And we knelt down by the bed. And he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. That's been 30-some years ago. Today, Debbie and Randy are officers in the church in Columbus, Georgia. Serve God faithfully for that many years. That's why. Number one, because God called me to the ministry. I'm thankful that right at 12 years ago, a group of folk in this church believed in me and called me to be their pastor. But I thought about it this morning. Most of you in this room didn't vote for me. Do you know that? Most of you didn't vote for me. Because you weren't here. God's brought you into our body over these years. And I thank God that he has. And no, we're not going to take a vote after service to see if you would agree. I was reading this week some things from John MacArthur. After being pastor of Grace Community Church for nearly 35 years, John was asked if he ever contemplated leaving the pastorate. His answer was, admittedly, there were times when even the prospect of digging ditches for a living had a certain appeal. But he says, I know God called me to be a pastor, and I've never really seriously considered bailing out. Seriously? There have been times I've prayed to get out. And God said, I called you and I haven't changed my mind. And my answer to him was, I answered you that I would follow you and I haven't changed my mind. And that has kept me in the ministry, has been God's call. We do love being appreciated. Anybody does. You do too. And we have been very blessed over these years. We have been gifted in some wonderful ways. We had a couple took us to Hawaii. That's a nice little gift if anyone wants an idea. And we did their wedding there. Early in our ministry here, some of the folk here sent us on a sweet little cruise. And it was precious. It was wonderful. We've had gifts. I won't go on into some of them. Some of them were just mind-boggling. Others were very personal. Many of you have made us things that are the treasures of our home. And we thank you for that. But I want you to know the greatest gift that we've ever received is to watch you do God's will. When you start to emulate the word that God has given us to share, every time we see you in ministry, we are moved with gratitude.